somebody move the projector.
Good morning. I'd like to welcome you to Memorial Baptist Church. We have a few announcements this morning. First, I believe there's something about a woman's retreat coming up that I believe an announcement wants to be made about.
The women's retreat, Longing for Home, takes place in 2 weeks, and tomorrow is the last day to register. The registration forms with all the details are by the front door, or if you have any questions, feel free to ask me or Penny Curler or Jane Kimball.
Thank you, Meredith. Well, let's prepare our hearts for worship.
Let's begin worship. Lord, we ask you now to come into your house. We invite you, Holy Spirit, to move among us, to tune us into your word through music, through prayer, through the act of communion. Lord, we invite you to move into our hearts, to convict us, to give us grace, to give us mercy, to show us how to see you during this Lenten period. And Lord, there's so many things as we sit in this room that threaten to take our attention from you. And so we pray, Father, that you keep our eyes drawn towards you. Remind us as we look at the table today through worship what it means to have a God who loved us enough to die for us. Father, be with us today, we pray. Amen.
Please rise to for our call to worship. Arise, shine, let your light, for your light has come.
Glory of the Lord has risen upon you.
The people walking in darkness have seen a great light.
Those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has come.
The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. The glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it.
Thanks be to God for this new life.
Would you please turn with me to hymn 117? We come, O Christ, to you.
Thank you.
Praise the Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name.
Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his debts.
Who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases.
Who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion.
Who satisfies your desires with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love.
He will not always refuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as we deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities.
For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken.
Amazing love, I know it's true. No,
As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear him, and his righteousness with their children's children, with those who keep his covenant and remember to obey his precepts. The Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all.
This song I sang last week, some of you were here for Ash Wednesday and heard it then. So this week we're gonna try singing it all together. We'll sing through the first verse, and this is the first verse, both the white and the yellow. So we'll sing it through once, and when you're comfortable, you can join in, and we'll start it over again at the beginning.
Oh, great God of highest heaven, occupy my lowly heart. Own it all and reign supreme. Conquer every rebel power. Let no vice or sin remain that resists your holy word. You have loved and purchased me. Forevermore.
Let us pray. Father, we thank you that you are all that we need, that you came and saved us in our deepest places, in our darkest moments, and that you took that to the cross and shed your blood to cover our sins. And we thank you for that great sacrifice. Pray that you'd continue to be with us this morning as we praise your name and worship you in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. I would ask the deacons to come forward to collect the deacon's offering, and you may be seated.
Thank you.
Communion, like we did last Lenten time, and that is intinction. So in just a moment, you're going to come forward and come down the center and fan through. What intinction means is you will put the bread in the cup and then take it up here. The psalmist that we recited today in Psalm 103 tells us the great good news of Jesus Christ, and that is that God does not pay us according to our iniquities, meaning that the sins that we have committed, he doesn't hold us to the level that he could. And the great good news of that is evidenced in this table, is that Jesus Christ took on our sins so that we don't have to pay the price of that iniquity. And so today as we look at the table, we're reminded of the sacrifice of Christ. We're reminded also of what Amber just sang, and that's grace. Come sit at the table. Come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary. That this is a table that's set before us to remind us not only are we not paid according to our iniquities, but that we're offered grace, that we're offered hope, and that we're offered rebirth. So today, as we invite you to come to the table, we invite you as brothers and sisters in Christ to really examine that, to thank God for that. On the night when Christ was crucified, he knew what he would face in the cross. He knew that he would face our entire sins placed upon him. And he knew that in those hours of agony, the worst would be what he would endure by the Father turning from him in those sins. And yet he did it. So that night as he passed the cup and as he passed the plate, he said, "This is my body that is broken for you. This is my blood." Because we don't have to be held accountable to our iniquities, we have the blood of another sacrifice, and that is Jesus Christ. We invite you to come forward. I'll invite the deacons to come to hold the cup and plate. pray. Gracious Lord, once again, we are in awe of you. We're in awe of how the psalmist describes you in your word, that your love for us is as far as the east is from the west, that you have compassion and grace upon us, that you have gone to the greatest ends of the earth to not only save us, but to get to know us, to have a relationship with us. So Lord, right now in the close of communion, we pray during this time, Father, for an awareness of you. Lord Jesus, we pray for a way for you to expose yourself to us anew and afresh. Allow us to see you and to feel you and to know you in ways during this Lenten time that we haven't before. And Lord, we pray right now if there are those in this room that are seeking, that aren't quite sure if you're the answer or a answer, that you would just pour your spirit out upon them. That you would fill us not with shame and not with guilt, but with hope and with love and an awareness of what it means to worship the great good news. Lord, we pray as we look around our room, we pray for healing. Thank you so much for all that you've done this week, for the many issues and ailments. Thank you that you've walked beside us. The promises in your word tell us that you won't leave us or forsake us. And Lord, we continue to pray for healing. Pray for Glenn, we pray for Marguerite. Pray for healing in Beth and in Alan. Lord, we pray for our children and our youth and our college students and all of our congregation to be protected and to be covered. Not to be walled in or fenced in, but protected so that we can do your word. Preach it and teach it and minister to those in this world. And Lord, as we look around our world, we pray for the many, many things that are going on. We pray for peace. We pray as Christians in a time of election that we will be known not for what we're against or who we blame, but that as Christians that we will be known for our faith in you, Lord, our love, our bridge building. And God, create in us a desire to do so. Create in us a desire to reach out to those who don't look anything like us or behave like us, and help us to find grace and mercy. God, allow us to be intentional in our witness, intentional with our life and with our words, and allow us to seek you with all that we have. For we ask all these things in your name. So we pray the prayer that you've taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Bless you.
At this time, the ushers will come forward for the morning's offering. time of greeting, Deb Wilkinson is going to come forward with a short mission moment.
Good morning. I come bearing greetings from Haiti and an opportunity to serve. After I read this, if you are so led, it's a mission in Haiti that, as you many of you know, many of us have gone to Haiti, and the town I'm going to talk about is a mountain town that's quite a drive to get to. If you think about driving through our rivers here in Vermont in a little Toyota 4x4, I think some of you have maybe after Irene came through. I think Jim did, went through the river. But anyway, it's a small town of Lavange. It's up on a beautiful mountain in Haiti. And I'm going to read to you from some folks we met there back in 2013. We met Renee and Wes Hunter. And they have started a mission called Hope Changes Everything. And it's an amazing ministry that sponsors children. On our last trip down, we just built a house for one of the sponsored children. And we hope that continues to grow as well. So we have partnerships around the world with so many people, so many that even attended this church. But here's a mission that is available to us, and I'm going to read you this letter from Renee. And she says, I am writing with extremely exciting news. In November 2013, I first visited Lavange, a mountain community near Grand Guave. Pastor Luke, the founder of Heart to Heart Orphanage, where we stayed when we were there and met Pastor Luke, wonderful, wonderful man of God, has built a church which doubles as a school there to serve children who previously had to walk 2 or 3 hours if they were to go to school. As soon as I arrived on this mountain, I knew God had a purpose for the visit. I soon learned that the children going to school there had no water to drink. Actually, this entire community has no water source. We hired someone to carry a bucket of water to the school each day. I questioned Pastor Luke about the possibility of a well, and he suggested we have an expert come to see if it could be done. After 3 years of praying and trying to get an answer, we have learned that a well can, in fact, be put on the site of the school. The well would serve the entire community of approximately 500 people. Some would walk as far as an hour one way to get this water. It is likely to be pure since it's high and the well will be deep. This would mean these people who have never had a water source would now have one. It would mean that people, many who are practicing voodoo, will be brought to the church to receive not only water, but also the news of living and loving God who gives us living water. Our next step will be to raise the money. Thus, the letter. Please pray about this and decide if you would like to be a part of this. The well drilling company can do the work in March if we can raise the money in time. It will only take them a day or two. I know this is a short time to raise the money, but these people have waited lifetimes for water. The cost of the well is $8,300. They have raised over $4,000 toward the well already. So they're well on their way. But she's putting this out to us because she knows that Memorial Baptist has prayed and has been sending teams and has a special place in our hearts. And I'm going to have Melinda put the address that you can send the money. Their church, Renee and Wes's church, is in Wilmington, North Carolina, and it's called Winter Park Baptist Church. And if you ever want to learn more about Haiti, they have a wonderful site, and you can learn about their trips to Haiti. And I will have her put the address in the bulletin, and you would send it to their church marked as for the well in Haiti. So if you would like to do this and you pray about it this week and God leads you to serve in this way, it would be an amazing thing. As we were just there and there's there is no water. Whatever you bring in, that's what you have. And they have this little stream, that's their only water source. And like I said, there's people bathing in it and animals going to the bathroom in it, and it's not a good water source. So if you feel led, keep Haiti in your prayers, and this is a great way to serve. Thank you.
Thank you, Deb. At this time, the children are dismissed for Children's Church, and we are going to have a time of greeting. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. Please be seated.
A reading from Isaiah 40. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her hard service has been completed, that her sin has been paid for, and that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice of one calling, in the wilderness prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill made low, and the road, rough ground, shall become level, the rugged places a plain. And the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all the people will see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken.
We share everything. A voice says, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry? All people are like grass, and all their faithfulness is like the flowers of the field. The grass withers and the flowers fall because the breath of the Lord blows on them. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of our God endures forever. You who bring good news to Zion, go up on a high mountain. You who bring good news to Jerusalem, lift up your voice with a shout. Lift it up, do not be afraid. Say to the towns of Judah, here is your God. See, the sovereign Lord comes with power, and he rules with a mighty arm. See, his reward is with him, and his recompense accompanies him. He tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms and carries them close to his heart. He gently leads those that have young. This is the word of God.
Does it feel like we've already had an entire service by this point? Are you wishing it was last week when it was shorter? We're going to read from the book of Mark in just a moment. Mark chapter 1. We're going to stick in Mark through all of Lent. So let's, as you're turning in there, we'll open with prayer. Lord, bless this time of teaching and preaching, and bless this your word. Allow it to speak to us, Father, and to open us up in ways to you. We ask these things in your name. Amen. So we're going to stay in Mark through Lent, and we began Lent, of course, on Ash Wednesday. Lent is very similar to Advent, which feels like that just happened, because it did just happen. And Lent and Advent are similar because they're periods of time that are waiting, but there's a different purpose for Lent than there is for Advent. So in Advent, we're waiting and we're looking down the pike for the baby Jesus to show up. And in Lent, we're looking down the pike for the crucifixion and the resurrection, which is a great Sunday, right? That's Easter. But during Lent, we're also taking this time, which is, it's about a 40-day period, actually a little bit more, but by Sundays. And we're taking that time to prayerfully consider our relationship with Jesus Christ. So Lent is a time of introspection and looking at our relationship, looking at Christ, seeking him. So if you can imagine, Advent is the light into darkness. Remember Jesus, that little light, baby Jesus? Then Lent is sight into darkness. And that sight is Jesus Christ. And so during Lent, we seek to figure out and to grow closer to Jesus and to have a better insight of him and our relationship. During Advent, we talked about how the angels proclaimed and announced the birth of Jesus. Well, before Jesus begins his ministry during Lent, that time is announced. And we're going to read that. For Mark's gospel, hear the announcement of Jesus into ministry. Mark 1, we're going to read verses 1 through 7. The beginning of the gospel about Jesus Christ, the Son of God. It is written in Isaiah the prophet, I will send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way. A voice of one calling in the desert, prepare the way for the Lord, make him straight, paths for him. And so John came, baptizing in the desert region and preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him, confessing their sins. They were baptized by him in the Jordan River. John wore clothing made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist. And he ate locusts and wild honey. And this was his message. After me will come one more powerful than I, the thongs of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Okay, keep your Bibles open because we're going to get back to the announcement in just a moment. But a question for you to ponder all of Lent. You ready for this? How would you describe Jesus? How would you describe Jesus? If someone asked you to describe Jesus as they did me recently, what would you say? Not what does he mean to you, and not what's your experience with Jesus, and not even what you believe about him, but how would you describe him to people? Son of God? Messiah? Prince of Peace? Yes, yes. But just like in Advent, those words don't really have a meaning to anybody else outside these walls. Sure, to other Christians, we toss those words around and we know what we mean. It's insider talk. But to a world where there are options and experiences and possibility, how do you deal with Jesus? How do you describe to a world that says he might be an option, a person who said, I'm not an option, I'm the truth, the way, and the life? How do you reconcile with that? What do you do with that? So during this Lenten time, that's my prayer for you, that's my prayer for me, is to grow in insight with Jesus Christ, but to seek him and to ask him specifically, Lord, how do I describe you to people? What do I say? Because Mark, the book we'll stay in, has a lot to say about the description of Jesus Christ. I know that's a lot. It's a huge, big request, right? But that's our homework during Lent. There was a Russian Orthodox archbishop by the name of Andrei Blum, who I loved to read his sermons and his homilies. He's deceased. He died in 2003. But Archbishop Blum was born in Russia. He was raised in Persia, Iran. And then when the Bolshevik Revolution took place in 1923, they had to flee and they went to Paris. And he has this great story about how he became a Christian. He says that through his life, he studied, by the way, other subjects. He studied medicine and science and chemistry and graduated with his doctorate in Paris. But along the way, he kept bumping into Christianity. He said as a child, he remembers seeing this priest who just extolled the love of Jesus, just lived out what it meant to be a Christian. And he said because of that, he was intrigued. But it didn't go any further than that. Then years later, a friend asked him to come hear an evangelism speech, a sermon, a talk about the virtues of Christianity. And he sat through it begrudgingly. And when he was done, he said he was so mad. He left there in a huff. He went home back to his dorm room and he said, I'm going to read the Bible and I'm going to disprove Christianity. So you don't have all night to read the Bible. What do? You pick the shortest gospel, the Gospel of Mark, and he read through. And he said, instead of disproving the Bible, the opposite happened. He said, that night, Jesus Christ gripped his soul and convicted him. And he became a Christian, and he never looked back, so to speak. He said, the book of Mark is just that book to do it to you. Mark is concise, it's to the point, it is direct, and Mark doesn't mince words. And one of the first things we see that Mark doesn't mince words is this opening verse, verse 1, chapter 1, look at it again. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. So Mark begins his book with Jesus being 30 years of age. This is not a biography of Jesus as we understand biographies in the traditional sense. This is a beginning of Jesus at the point of his ministry. And let me give you a little info on Mark. Mark will leave you breathless. Mark likes to rush through life. Mark's gospel uses more present tense action verbs in the Greek than any of the other books. So ancient scholars have animal depictions of the books, the gospels. For instance, John is depicted as an eagle. Mark is depicted as a lion. You know why? Because everywhere you go, Jesus pounces on the scene. And so Jesus shows up, and he's 30 years of age in Mark's gospel. Mark has no tolerance for the drivel that Luke picks up. All those things that were hidden in Mary's heart, Mark's not interested. He's interested in telling a story, and he's telling it as fast as he can tell it, and he is in a hurry. And in the not mincing words category, he shoots right out the gate with this statement, undeniable, descriptive of who Jesus is, the Son of God. Now, if you're an astute reader, you read that first verse and you realize, hey, wait a minute, there's no main verb in that sentence. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. What is that? Is that a title? Is that him just being in such a hurry he forgot the verb in the sentence? What is this about? Okay, language break for a second. If you're at the point in the service where you're like, oh, I need a nap, you got 30 seconds. You ready? In Hebrew, the absence of the to be verb is implied. To be verb is, was, am, are. So oftentimes in Hebrew, you'll have the absence of that in a sentence and you write it in when you're translating. So in Hebrew, this sentence could be translated, this is the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Problem is, this isn't Hebrew. This is Greek, and Greek works differently. The absence of a main verb in Greek forces dependency either on the preceding sentences or the sentence that follow. And if the sentences are preceding, you'll often look for a reflexive verb that ties it together in dependency. Ephesians chapter 5, that famous women, wives, submit to your husband. What people forget is that it's missing a verb in that sentence. It's dependent upon the previous verb, which is a reflexive verb, hyptoso, meaning wives submit to your husbands and husbands submit to your wife. It's mutual. The absence of any preceding sentences in this means that all the dependency comes after. So the question then becomes, what's the good news? Is it Jesus? Is it his ministry? Is it the miracles? Is it his teaching? Yes. All of the above. The lack of intentional verb place in this sentence means that he is using ambiguity to force your attention that anything that follows is good news. Anytime in Mark's gospel, when there's an exorcism, a healing, a parable, a story, a narrative, a miracle, a teaching, what Mark is telling us is that that's the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ. This is the news that we have been waiting for, Mark is saying, our whole life. In fact, this is the news that the Israelites have been waiting for their whole life. And that's why he starts with Malachi and Isaiah. And he points to two passages that talk about somebody coming, but a preparer, a forerunner, that will come and point people back to Christ. Jesus is this good news, and he tells us the person who announces this good news, the forerunner, is John the Baptist. Remember John the Baptist from Advent? Son of Elizabeth, son of Zechariah, the miracle baby that gets foretold in the temple when Zechariah can't talk. John grows up. He's not like all the other little kids. He grows up as a Nazarite. He never cuts his hair. He never drinks wine. He never marries. He never has children, and he never has a job. His whole purpose is to announce Jesus Christ as the good news. Okay, pause. Who cares? No, really, who cares, right? I mean, I'm not trying to be inflammatory or provocative. Who cares? What Mark is telling us is that we've been waiting our whole life for this good news. Okay, so what? What does that mean to other people? What does that mean to us? The definition of good news is something that is life-changing or life-altering. Good news, I got a job. Good news, we had a baby. Good news, I got a promotion. Good news, I got into a relationship. Good news, I no longer have cancer. Good news, I won the lottery, right? Life-changing, life-altering. Is Jesus Christ that kind of news for you? Is he that kind of news for me? And here's the thing, in a privatized world that tells you that's great if he's good news for you, just keep it to yourself, is he good news to everybody else? What does this mean? A couple of weeks ago, I spent a Tuesday with somebody I'd never met before. Several hours with a person I had no knowledge of before. They had no knowledge of me. And of course, you get into those topics of what do you do for a living? And, you know, I can't lie. So once I tell them what I do, then it's the unbearable why I don't go to church conversation, which is always awkward. And I always feel guilty because I don't want my job to have to induce that kind of guilt and shame. And so I kept trying to change the subject and talk about children or talk about the weather, and it kept coming back. And the whole time, you know what I was thinking? How do I make Jesus Christ equivalent to winning the lottery for this person? How do I make Jesus Christ so exciting to a person who keeps telling me, I ought to get back in church, but you know what, I really just don't see the point. You see what I'm talking about, how hard it is to talk about good news? 20 years ago, I heard the great missionologist Charles Kraft say, when the answer to the question was, what's the hardest thing about missions? You know what he said? That the good news is only good news if you deem it so. What Charles Kraft was saying is, if you go into an area where people are starving and you say Jesus is good news, but they have no food, it's hard for them to see that Jesus is good news. Do you see how difficult this is? It's almost like we have to convince people they need good news before we can even begin to tell them the good news of Jesus Christ. So when we use that phrase in Christian circles, it doesn't get the same buzz to everybody else. What does it mean? And how do we describe Jesus as good news? Because what Mark is saying is an integral part of understanding Jesus Christ is that he is the good news. So how do we do it? Look at Mark. He gives us some really good instructions on how to do this. First, he tells us that Jesus, as the good news, is the promise of God fulfilled. So when he talks to us about John the Baptist, and he quotes Isaiah and he quotes Malachi, what he's telling us is that Jesus Christ was planned from the very beginning to be the answer to our problems, to bridge us back to God. And he uses, again, Malachi and Isaiah, and he's kind of referencing Exodus in there too. In other words, what he's saying is, look, John is not some cosmic accident, or Jesus Christ isn't some cosmic serendipitous situation. It was planned by God. At this time for Mark, quoting Malachi and quoting Isaiah, Isaiah is probably close to 700 years before Mark. Malachi is somewhat around 400, and Exodus could be upwards of 1200. So what he's saying is God keeps his promises. The great good news is God keeps his promises, and implied in that is that God is not in a hurry to keep his promises. Okay, so how do we describe the great good news of Jesus Christ as the promise fulfilled? It means that all the words that were ever used to talk about God are fulfilled in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the great good news when we describe it means that we can say with assurance God keeps his promises. And so when we're in those places in our lives where we need assurance, we can go to God's word and we can understand with certainty that God will keep his promise. You know a great promise in the word of God that Jesus Christ says? Hebrews 13:5. Jesus says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. In describing Jesus Christ as good news, how much better does it get than that promise? When we go through those periods of life where it's dark and it's lonely and we're scared and we're terrified because we live in a fallen world, the great good news is Jesus is the culmination of all promises, is he will never leave us nor forsake us. It doesn't get any better than that. Next up, Mark tells us that he is the embodiment of the Word of God. What that means, remember back in Advent I said that Jesus was the Word made flesh? Well, Jesus is the embodiment of those promises fulfilled because he's the embodiment of all of this. Later on in the New Testament, you know what Jesus will say? He'll say all of the Old Testament, doesn't call it the Old Testament, but all of the scriptures, they're talking about me. They're talking about me. All of that is the fulfillment of Jesus Christ. Let me read to you from Ephesians what Paul says about Jesus. It says, he, God, made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ to be put into effect when the times reached their fulfillment, to bring all things unity in heaven and on earth under Christ. You know what that means? That the embodiment of the Word of God, all the promises fulfilled, the great good news of Jesus Christ, is that he came to make a way back to God. He's the bridge back to God. And how is that bridge announced? It's announced in the wilderness when Jesus begins his ministry. It's incredibly important. Mark is using this idea of wilderness because he understands what it means. The word wilderness in Hebrew, midbar, means from words. Mem is from, it's a preposition in Hebrew. Dibar means words. So when you talk about wilderness, it's a period where God would take you out of your normal environment to talk to you. Four times the word wilderness is used in this passage when Mark is talking about how the announcement of Jesus Christ as the bridge back to God will be made. And who's the one crying out in the wilderness? John the Baptist. John the Baptist is in the wilderness because the people are in the wilderness, not literally, but metaphorically. And the Malachi Isaiah passages, the other four times that wilderness is used here, is in reference to the time when the Israelites are in wilderness, either literally, as in the Exodus, or under Assyrian, Babylonian, Persian, or Roman occupation. They are waiting for the Messiah, and so Mark is pulling these strings together and saying, the announcement, the bridge back to God, is being made, and it's being made in the wilderness. John's in the wilderness because the people are in the wilderness. But he makes this description of John. Look at Mark. He says that John is in the wilderness, and he looks like a wild man in the wilderness. By the way, Jesus will, of course, go into the wilderness. We'll talk about that in a few weeks. After his baptism, God will usher him in there to talk to him and to spend time. He will be tested. He will be cultivated right after his baptism. But John the Baptist spending time in the wilderness looks like one crazy dude, right? Camel hair clothing. What is that? No, that was not in vogue, okay? This is weird. You know how they got camel hair clothing? You didn't shave a camel. You know what you did? You waited until the camels walked by the brush, and whatever got stuck in the thorns, you bound up, and you made clothing. That's what he's doing. This is weird. Not only that, he has this kind of like leather belt thing to hold up his half-made camel tunic, and then he's eating wild honey and locusts. He is bizarre, and he's sitting there, and he's crying out in the wilderness for people to come. And guess what? They do come. They come in droves. Verse 5 tells us that Jerusalem and all of Judea is emptied out because they're coming to this guy who's in the desert, crying out, preparing the way for Jesus Christ. Why does he look so strange? Because he is living the part. He is, in every fiber of his being, the pinnacle of what points people to Jesus Christ as a prophet and as a forerunner. And what this tells us is the great good news of Jesus Christ is when you meet him, your life is never the same. John the Baptist is not some ordinary looking dude in the desert crying out an alternative to the world. He is an alternative to the world, pointing people to the alternative to the world. Because when you meet Jesus, the expectations of Jesus is not the expectation of our world. Okay, great. So what does that mean that we have to describe people as? That we need a savior? That we need to repent? Because that's what John is saying, and he's a forerunner to Christ. Repent, by the way, doesn't mean you're sorry. Repent means you turn and go in a different direction. So John's not staying out there in his wild man clothing screaming, you need to say sorry. He's saying you need to be different. Be because when you meet Jesus, you are. Okay, so we say we need to be different to people, and that sums up the good news. What does this mean? Well, there's one more thing that Mark says John does, right? He's a herald. You know what a herald is? Throughout the Old Testament, the heralds were the ones that the kings employed to run out ahead and to scream. You know those guys who stand on the street corner holding the signs up for the store? They're the silent heralds. But in the ancient world, a herald would be loud, and they would run out ahead announcing something. You didn't have billboards in the ancient world. So in Genesis, Pharaoh tells people to run out ahead of Joseph's chariot and scream, "Bow the knee!" And in Nebuchadnezzar, remember we just finished this in Daniel? His heralds run out and scream, "Bow before the image!" And then in Hezekiah, when there's reforms, his heralds run out and say, "Go to Jerusalem and celebrate the Passover." A herald worked for the king. A herald announced the king. So John, as this crazy man in the desert, is a herald working for the king, Jesus Christ. And what he is saying is, prepare your hearts to stand before the Lord. Okay. Do we do that about Jesus Christ? The other day, as I was talking to that woman, you know what I'm thinking? Do I herald Jesus? Do I'm running out before heralding the good news of Jesus Christ? Do I even believe that the good news of Jesus Christ is life-changing for that woman? Or do I think it's just life-changing for me? You all know that I love talking about healthy food, right? Vitamins, minerals, supplements. I can't hold back. I get so excited. When people start talking about they got an ache or pain or they're tired or they've got, I mean, I've got it. I'll bring my books out. I love talking to people. And when it happens, I don't even like hold back. Like I start getting excited and I'll talk about the benefits of green juice or I'll talk about raw milk. It is controversial. It is potentially judgmental, but there is no clearinghouse in my head before I start talking about it. I will herald the benefits of eating differently, but do I do that about Jesus Christ? You know what I do about Jesus Christ? This thing goes through my head going, should I say that? Oh, wait, I don't want to seem judgmental. Oh, no, but I know it's good for them, but oh, man, I got to hold back. I don't do that about green juice, right? What's the difference? My brother Kyle, obsessed with motorcycles. Kyle can't hold back. Can't hold back. Kyle's part of a Christian biker evangelism gang. How cool is that, right? How cool is that? They evangelize at biker shows. And Kyle, man, he lights up like a Christmas tree when he talks about motorcycles. Do we talk about Jesus like that? That's what a herald does. Is that there's no clearinghouse in your head that says, I shouldn't say this, I gotta say this, but I shouldn't say this. You just say it. And that's what John the Baptist is doing. One more thing Mark says about John the Baptist is that he's out there, he's preaching about repentance, he's preaching baptism, and he is performing baptism. And he is a sign of what will come in Jesus' ministry. What John is saying to us is the great good news is that we are able to stand before God with Jesus Christ as a bridge back, not in shame, but in understanding our sin and coming out on the other side of it. Look at verse 5 again. It tells us that they were coming out. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him, confessing their sins. This might be a little bit of hyperbole, but even if it is, could you even fathom? We've never seen anything like this. Thousands and thousands and thousands of people coming out to this wild guy in the desert who's preaching not health and wealth, but repentance of sin. This word confessing in Greek, I love this word, eklomagio. Ek means out of, and holomagio means holy. So what, not holy as in H-O-L-Y, but W-H-O-L-L-Y, holy as in full. And what this word means is, I confess, I admit, I acknowledge. In the Hellenistic overuse of the middle voice, it means I acknowledge a debt. What people are coming out and seeing him and hearing him preach is that they are acknowledging their need to repent and to be saved. And what does John say? I'm going to baptize you with water, but the one who comes after me will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. The great good news is in Jesus Christ, we can stand before God. On this side of heaven, we cannot stand before God face to face because of sin. He is too holy. He is too powerful. We will just diminish in his sight. But because of Jesus Christ, we can stand before Jesus Christ and we can look at our sin and we can ask for forgiveness and we can change. We don't have to stand in front of Jesus with shame and with guilt. And we don't have to spend the entire narrative of our life living out the same thing. We can change. Jesus says to us, I came not to condemn, but to give you life. That is the great good news of Jesus Christ. Okay, again, how do we describe that to people? Because in our world, when you have to convince people they need something before we even begin to describe it, what do these words mean? See, oftentimes when I hesitate about describing Jesus as the great good news, this is not a statement about Jesus being the great good news. It's a statement about my hesitation to describe him as the great good news. Because Mark says, look, this is a fact. This isn't up for debate. He is the great good news. One of my favorite quotes that Andrew Bloom, that archbishop, said, and it's on the front of your bulletins, he said that if the Gospels were lost, could they be rewritten by looking at your life? Wow. If the Gospels were lost, could my life describe Jesus Christ? That's amazing. Again, in our world, sometimes you feel like the great good news of Jesus Christ has to be unpacked from the rubble of all the stuff that we've put on top of it. It doesn't seem like great good news. It seems like an option. Or just information, or just junk if you need it. There was an article in the Washington Post about the Iowa primaries recently. By the way, one of my favorite things to do is to watch how the religion flag flies during the primaries. It's fascinating to me. You know why people fly that flag during the primaries? Because still to this day, 53% of people believe that the president needs to believe in God. It's pretty fascinating, pretty big statistic. So of course they all fly them. But in Iowa, a few primaries ago, there was a man this article talked about by the name of Justin Scott, and in it, he's an atheist. And so what Justin Scott did, he's a self-employed photographer. He went to every single meet and greet of every single candidate, big candidate, small candidate, and everything in between, and he asked every single one of them questions about what it means to be an atheist and what they feel about atheists and what they feel about the separation of church and state and why should an atheist vote for them. Okay. He said that Donald Trump and Rand Paul totally ignored him. He said Rubio, Clinton, and Sanders gave great answers. He said John Kasich, the Ohioan, really irritated him because when Justin Scott announced that he was an atheist, Kasich said, well, just don't give up on your Bible. He said that just really made me mad, which is so funny because that's exactly what turned Andre Blum into a Christian, was reading the Bible. But anyway, here's the best quote from the article. He said he did this because he wanted to know, and I quote, when push comes to shove, are you making decisions based on superstition and a book written 2,000 years ago, or are you using evidence-based approach? Are you using superstition and a book written 2,000 years ago, or are you using evidence-based approach? When we describe Jesus Christ as the good news, folks, there is nothing superstitious about it. And I think this is critical for us to get down in apologetics. That in the Word of God, the description of Jesus Christ is not based on experience alone. The shepherds don't find that baby because they had a feeling, right? Mark doesn't say it's my experience that he's the Son of God. No, no, no. He says he is the Son of God, and let me give you testimony in Malachi and Isaiah to point to him. The disciples, when they give eyewitness account of who Jesus is, it's not based on their feelings. Thomas has to actually see the holes in Jesus' hands before he'll believe it. The evidence is there. The burden is on us to be those heralds. When I read that about Justin Scott, I didn't get irritated with him. Honestly, I wanted just to give the dude a hug and say, there is great good news in Jesus Christ. Okay, so it's a few suggestions of how we do this. These are three things we can really quickly walk out with. Number one, when we talk about Jesus' good news, do we use the language of faith? Do we use the language of faith freely? Do we say things out in the world like, praise the Lord, I'm alive today, or thank you, God, when something happens to us? Or do we censor ourselves and put our language through that clearinghouse and say, I just really can't say that? Do we do that? We don't have to be like Ned Flanders, okay? But we don't have to be those dorky Christians. But if we have a language of faith in here, do we have a language of faith out there? Number two, when we describe Jesus Christ as good news, do we think that we have to have people saved, or do we leave that up to God? Are we success and results driven before we'll talk, or do we just talk? You know, do we say things like, I know he's the great good news, and I know he could help your life, but I don't want to say that because who am I to say that to you? A witness, a martyria in Greek, is just that, a witness. It is just our job to witness. It is not our job to have success. And then last, when we describe Jesus Christ as the great good news, do we pray for boldness? You know, in the first church with the disciples, they prayed for boldness. By the way, in the first church, extra biblical documentation shows that in Acts, they were being criticized. They were told to stop talking. They were never told it was wrong, and they were never told there wasn't evidence to the resurrection. They were told to shut up. You know what they did? They went back to the rooms. They didn't pray for power. They didn't pray for God to make them right. You know what they prayed for? Boldness. Make me bold. The most amazing thing happens when God puts you in places. In Advent, I told you that I lived in a world of a Christian bubble. Remember me telling you that? All of a sudden with Soren, I'm in a world of non-Christian bubbles. I'm surrounded every single week by tens and 20 people, neonatologists, audiologists, pulmonologists, neurologists. I've got pediatricians and nurses and occupational therapists and physical therapists. And every single day, I have to make that choice to let the good news go through that clearinghouse or to pray for boldness to be able to use the language of faith in a very, very powerful way. This is as difficult for me as it is for any of us. But the great good news doesn't change based on our perception. He is the great good news. Let's pray. Lord, as you take us into your world in just a few moments, remind us of that, of what it means to worship a God who will never leave us or forsake us, who came to give us life and life everlasting. Lord, we pray for boldness. In your name we pray. Amen.
If you will turn with me to hymn number 382 for our closing hymn, Be Thou My Vision, please rise.
Thank you.
God, lead us out into your world. Allow us to be light bearers. Allow us to be forerunners and heralds of the good news, we pray. Amen.